Welcome once again to Chicago Clout. This is Frank Avila, your host. I want to thank you for watching. Today we have former alderman of the 23rd Ward and former city clerk of the city of Chicago, Jim Laski. Thank you for being on our show.
Thanks for having me, Frank.
And I want to get right into the show and talk about a book that I would suggest anybody to read. It's called My Fall from Grace, City Hall to Prison Walls. I've known you, alderman, I guess since you were alderman. I'm calling you alderman, but you're city clerk. And I remember we worked on a resolution together for school choice after you had broke with Lipinski.
Right.
And also on some of the property tax stuff. I remember you were on Verdoliak's radio show. You had voted against the property tax increase. And I remember we did a little writing together on the property tax issue and school choice. So I've known you for quite some time. And you would have been like one of the last people I ever thought that would get in trouble. And when I read it without offending you, when I found out the amounts involved, I said, well, why is this guy without offending? It's stupid.
Right.
Okay? Because it wasn't $1 million. You have Huels took a $1 million loan from Mike Payton. Okay, that might be worth it. Not worth it. For my viewing audience, so I don't get a lot of letters, I'm not saying it's worth it, but, you know, when people joke around, if you're going to go to jail, what's worth going to jail for?
Correct.
Okay? and so the amounts were relatively small. But let's go a little bit in past. Let's talk a little bit from the start. You were telling before the show a story about one of your first experiences in politics. And the precinct captain came to your door.
Absolutely.
And he promised you a summer job.
Right.
He needed,
I was living with my folks. He comes to the house and says to my folks and I, you know, I need some votes. There's a governor's race coming up. I need you to vote for Adlai Stevenson.
1982, a very famous race, because that's when Adlai Stevenson night was winning.
No, I think it was the first election. I think it was the 78 one.
Okay.
But whatever. And he says, I need your vote for Stevenson. Well, anyway, I'm back in law school, living in the away from home, and I had an absentee ballot sent to me. When I was at law school, a gentleman comes to campaign there.
Northern Illinois,
correct. And a guy comes in his flannels and jeans and his two golden retrievers by the name of Jim Thompson. And he gives his fire and brimstone speech. And I kind of like the guy. So when my absentee ballot comes, I voted for Jim Thompson.
Who was also a professor of law at Northwestern University.
Right. Okay. So I vote for Jim Thompson. The summer comes and goes, and I don't get the summer job. Okay. So that fall, the following fall, the precinct captain comes back to the house and says to me, I need your help. Another election coming up. Can I do anything for you? I said, do anything for me? I says, you know, I didn't get the summer job last year. And he says, yeah, I know. And I says, what do you mean, you know? And he said, you didn't vote for the right guy. And I said, I didn't vote for the right guy. I voted absentee. He says, yeah, I know.
So already back then, they knew how you were voting absentee.
Right. This was an absentee that I filled out in law school. Put a stamp on it, sealed it, and mailed it back to the Board of Elections, thinking that, you know, my vote is secret and whatever. And this was back in the late 70s, where they knew then how people voted.
Mm-hmm.
So that was my introduction to politics, and that should have told me back then I should have stayed out of the business, but I got into the business.
Well, let's fast forward a little bit on the vote fraud. Yeah, it just got revisited recently. Jerry Hurkis, who I'm sure you know well, mm-hmm. who was the chief of staff to Congressman Lipinski, Dan Lipinski, and was chief of staff to Congressman Lipinski, was in the papers recently because he said that he got the pork when Oak Lawn wanted to have a lobbyist, and they revisited that he was supposedly registering people in the 80s in Bohica's bar.
Right.
And I think even into the 90s that he was in the bar and that people were registered in Bohica's bar. So vote fraud is not something of the past, of the Kennedy election. Vote fraud is something that's still here.
Right. And you know what? If you look at the history of the 23rd Ward, you'll see the amount of absentee ballots that were generated under the 23rd Ward over the years. You'll see that there was cases where the state's attorney brought charges against individuals in the organization over the years, and that's well documented how many people got charged and had to pay fines or whatever for different types of vote fraud, so it's not uncommon. Well,
I remember, actually, this matter of history, I said it's for so long now, and I'm a lawyer, relatively successful. You're out of politics, so it doesn't matter, but I was the one who introduced you to Jim Nalepa,
right?
If you remember.
Absolutely.
And Jim Nalepa, I think if you would have supported him in that year only, because that was a big Republican year,
it was a year that
Newt Gingrich took the Congress,
right.
And 1994, every single Now that the Democrats are so powerful and the Republicans are so out, people forget 1994 when the Republicans took every state office, beat Madigan, took the House and the Senate, paid Philip and Lee Daniels.
And that was Lipinski's closest election?
Closest election. I think it was even closer than his primary in 1992 against Marty Russo.
Correct.
But I remember you at first were teaming up with Nalepa. And the leper told me if he had, who was Don Zukowski, Ray Drish, and there was one more guy, I can't think of his name.
Rajewski?
Younger guy, Polish name, but younger, skinnier guy. But
Bobby Burns was involved?
No, not Bobby. But I, the name will come to me, and he said he thinks he could have won the election. But Nalepa, I remember Bill Lipinski was doing an interview during the Nalepa election, and they mentioned the precinct captain's name. I don't remember the name of the precinct captain. And he said, oh, he's a great precinct captain. And he goes, well, why is he registered to vote from a vacant lot? And why are all these people registering to vote from a vacant lot? So there have been allegations of vote fraud, and they are fairly common in the city of Chicago. The reason it concerns me is that Mike Casper, who's done legal work for Mike Zalewski and the House seats, who's Madigan's lawyer, was a lobbyist for the Sequoia Company. The Sequoia Company, which got the contract that Victor Reyes was also involved with, for the touchscreen voting.
Oh, okay.
And if you remember the first election, there was a lot of controversy. You didn't have the results for a month. People supposedly won, then lost. So the touchscreen voting. So it's interesting that there's a continuity, almost a hermeneutic of continuity, in terms of vote fraud. It's a culture.
And like you said, this goes way back. We can talk about the Kennedy and Nixon elections and the old man Daley and how they were talking about how that election was won or stolen or whatever. It goes on and on and on. It's just the mindset. It's the culture of Chicago politics.
Now, but let's talk about what you saw personally. You also talk in your book about how you opened up a ballot box, or you saw the ballot box being opened, and the chads were off for Lipinski.
No, what I said in the book was is that I actually saw absentee ballots being changed 20 years ago. It was going on.
But you actually saw it.
I actually saw absentee ballots being changed. I actually saw dead people voting. But what I mean by dead people voting,
you didn't see them come up from the grave and vote.
No, but I knew a person might have been deceased, and they weren't taken off the rolls. The ballots and the poll sheets and somebody else came in and voted for them.
Okay, so you didn't really got started getting involved in politics then.
Late '70s.
Late '70s, you were in law school. You actually voted Republican for Jim Thompson,
correct.
And you shouldn't have. Now, were these the precinct captains of then Alderman Bill Lipinski?
Of Alderman Bill Lipinski, correct. Yes.
Okay. Now, so how did you get involved with Alderman Bill Lipinski's organization?
Well, after I didn't get the summer job, I pursued the precinct captain. The precinct captain talked to Lipinski. I actually went to see Bill Lipinski, and he liked my background. I was a young guy out of college, law school.
From the area,
from
Polish,
the area, Poland,
law school.
Right, right. And he asked me if I'd like to work on his staff. And I remember I started off as a gopher, making $16,000 a year back in 1979. I started June 16th, 1979 for Lipinski. And I became gopher. And then I worked for a guy who did his press stuff, Ray McDonald, a great guy. And I became the press secretary and eventually the chief of staff. And
now you were the chief of staff while he was still alderman.
I became chief of staff after he became congressman.
Okay.
And then
now,
Bill
were you
Christinia
involved
became
with the
alderman.
Big 82 race mm-hmm. where he was running
against,
for congressman?
Against Ferry.
That he was allied with Daley,
right.
That Burke was against him, Byrne was against him, Verdoliak was against him,
right.
And he was allied with
Swinarski, Daley, Madigan, I don't know who else.
So that was the key race, though, because I would say, and you tell me if I'm wrong, 82 was a key race for Lipinski and your organization.
Right.
92 was a key race.
Because they remapped and he had to run against Russo, right?
And 94 was a key race.
Right.
And in each race, you played a key role. I know in 94, but for you, Nalepa might have won if he had a stronger showing in the city, because he did very well in the suburbs, and it wasn't like 52-48 or 50-50, it was something very close.
Yeah, I had some decisions to make in 94 because I had already left Lipinski. I was deciding if I was going to run for re-election for alderman or run for citywide or run for Congress. I wasn't sure what I was going to do. Mm-hmm. And I was trying to pick and choose my fights very carefully. even though Nalepa was a young, aggressive, very intelligent West Point guy.
West Point grad, good-looking, good speaker.
I mean, I was just, I kind of played it, along the, I waffled a little bit. And
you were politically flirting with him, though, at the beginning.
Absolutely, absolutely. We talked a lot, and I was...
He came to some of your events.
Absolutely, we were strongly considering my organization voting for him, supporting him. And
do you think that helped Bill Lipinski push back to you so he eventually did support you for clerk?
He and I started talking more back in 94 because he needed,
you for Congress.
Right. He needed me and we had a local newspaper that I was funding and he needed, his name in that
paper.
I
remember you did some stories on property tax.
We picked up a guy from the old Roy Koz used to work at the Southwest News Herald. But anyway, there's a lot of history there. But I think in 94 Lipinski needed my help. Let's be honest, I probably wanted his help, whatever I was going to do in 95.
Right. And you already then, you had started getting some inklings of the city clerk position.
Correct. Well, that was all Bobby Malaro and Mark.
That was Bobby Malaro's idea.
We all sat down and he came up with the idea, and I said, that's not a bad idea.
It was a good idea. Bobby Malaro was a peacemaker. He came up with a good idea.
Run citywide. Run citywide.
It benefited Lipinski.
Yeah.
So you were there in 82 when he first ran.
Right.
And that was, I talked to State Representative Jim Phelan, who told me that you had the old 25th Ward Marzullo, you had the outfit, you had, really strong precinct captains, vote fraud on the other side, you had Ed Burke, I think even Pete Andrews was around at that time. So you had a lot of the big players that are still around today that were against you guys, and you went with... You went with Lipinski. Now, were you involved with the 80 race with Daley? That Lipinski
right.
was with Daley?
I just started off. I started with Lipinski in 79, so I played a minimal role. I was just, like I said, a gopher at the time, and if anything, I had a precinct. I was a precinct captain. So.
Okay. And then you were involved in the race against Marty Russo.
Correct. At that point in time, that was...
92.
That was just before I left Lipinski, so I was alderman then. Yeah.
Okay. Now, a lot of names have come up through the Lipinski ranks that you've seen, although Malaro originally was Marzullo, and then he was 12th Ward Committeeman and Alderman, and then State Senator, and then because of the remapping, he went to you. But you've been involved with former State Representative James Phelan, now State Representative, former State Senator, former Committeeman Alderman Bobby Malaro. Tony Perica, the Republican, came up through your ranks.
Yes.
He was a Democrat in the 23rd Ward. So there was a lot of talent that was there. Tony Perico is now the county commissioner, who almost beat Todd Stroger, Jim Phelan, Bob Malaro, a lot of operatives. Was that fair to say? Wally Carr,
absolutely.
Greg Swan.
Absolutely. But some of them, the Pericas and the Phelans, they didn't get their opportunities to shine as much as they could have if the old guard would have pushed them more.
Now, was there animosity because Lipinski did pick you and push you more than he picked a Phelan or a Perica?
There was always animosity in Lipinski's organization because there was always people chomping at the bit to run for office. And that, you got to remember, back in 90, I was appointed. Kristiniak took a county job, and Lipinski had the appointment there. So, and there was other people who wanted the spot. And I was I was around since 79, so I was around 11 years. But other people wanted the aldermanic seat, but Lipinski gave it to me.
Okay.
So.
Now, when you broke with Lipinski, because you got appointed alderman, Daley had already been elected mayor in 89. And in 1990, then it was Dick Phelan who became Cook County Board President. So you broke at a time where Lipinski was very strong.
Right.
You did not break at a time where Lipinski was weak.
Right.
Because Daley had just been elected mayor. Lipinski was a longtime Daley supporter since 79-80 for the state's attorney race, bucking Byrne and Burke and Verdoliak. And moreover, with Phelan in power and Daley in power, there was, I don't know how many jobs you had, but hundreds, maybe to a top figure of 1,000 jobs.
Sure.
Because when Kristiniak left, he went to be head of
Highway Department.
But it would be considered head of patronage.
Right, in the county, right.
And in fact, Kristiniak also, I don't know if he got in trouble, but he certainly has been named in recent federal pleadings, indictments. I don't know if he's cooperated. I don't know if he's testified. But you have seen his name in papers. You have seen what appears to be him in federal pleadings because he was in charge of jobs.
Right.
Is that fair to say?
That's fair to say.
Okay. So you didn't have the same access to jobs as aldermen.
Correct.
But at the same time, would it be fair to say that the bungalow belt hated property taxes so much that these homeowners not small homeowners, middle class people.
They were looking for a voice.
Yeah.
And I became that voice for them. And a lot of people said I was crazy because Lipinski was probably at his strongest because he had Daley, he had Dick Phelan. Okay, you know, he had county jobs, he had city jobs, you know, so yeah, he was at his strongest, and I was rolling the dice because I said, I'm going to stop this, you know.
But on the western end of your ward, you always had a lot of independent firefighters and cops mm-hmm. who didn't owe the precinct captain anything, who didn't want their property taxes increased, and you also became a voice for the firefighters. I recall when you and Judge Murphy,
right.
Alderman Murphy, you became the top firefighter guys.
We flew to Pennsylvania. We flew to Penn State University to find the missing exams. I remember that. Yeah.
So you defended the firefighters. And would it be fair to say in the 23rd Ward, you were a more conservative, white ethnic, kind of white ethnic voice?
Oh, absolutely. But I was always a big supporter of the policemen and firemen because I always thought they never got their fair share. I still don't think they get their fair share. And I was a strong voice for those guys.
But were you also more conservative? Because I remember one thing you backed away from. When you ran for city clerk, you became more pro-gay rights. And Rick Garcia embraced you. But when you were, as alderman, you actually supported
HIV testing.
I think it was Edward Doliak's
idea. Edward Doliak's idea. And it was a radio show. And I was flying, you know, riding.
Which
with
may have played well in the 23rd Ward.
But it didn't play well.
It didn't play well citywide.
No. But those were my young days before I...
Yeah. But also you were playing the 23rd Ward. Now it's becoming more Hispanic, especially by Pulaski, especially east of Pulaski. But at that time, it was a strong, ethnic, Catholic, conservative, maybe even racially tinged ward. Is that fair to say?
Right. Absolutely.
Now, Ray Hanania wrote an article on Bill Lipinski. We actually wrote it on Mayor Daley and the 80s, which you lived through part of, during the Byrne and Harold Washington eras, and maybe to talk a little bit about it. And one thing that Ray Hanania wrote, and I think he's close to Bill Lipinski still.
He still is.
Is Ray Hanania wrote that opposition to the post office was code word for blacks.
Okay.
Is that true? Was race a big factor with Bill Lipinski? Was Bill Lipinski playing a race card then when he was congressman with the 23rd Ward?
Well, Bill Lipinski's district, his congressional district, was majority white. So, I mean, any issues that came up, I mean, that Lipinski would support would be geared towards his, you know, the majority of his constituency. I mean, Bill Lipinski was a big supporter of the English language being the, you know, the language of, you know, of the national language. Bill Lipinski always took upon himself the conservative views that would represent the district, and if that meant white middle class conservatives, that's what he would do. I mean, he was a Reagan a Democrat.
Right.
Lipinski.
Well, the 23rd Ward went 2-1 for Reagan,
yeah.
Even though it was a Democrat ward.
Right.
But it was.
But Lipinski has always been a closet Republican. So. You know.
No, but do you think he's a racist?
No, I don't think he's a racist. But I think he'll do what he has to do to, you know, to represent his district. He did what he had to do to represent his district.
Now, in the 80s, it was alleged, and you were around there at the time then, that he was given an opportunity by Harold Washington to become head of parks. And head of parks at that time, replacing Ed Kelly, would have meant, I don't know, I'm assuming thousands of jobs, but massive patronage. And that was a time where you really still could give patronage. But that he couldn't take that head of park. Well, first of all, do you know if that's true? Did Harold Washington offer?
I think there was an opportunity for him to do that. But see, during this time with the Harold Washington, it was such a volatile time in the city. And I remember being at Lipinski's office or driving by Lipinski's office on the weekends, and he'd be having meetings with the Verdoliaks and the Ed Burks and the Jane Burns, and so there was always things going on that I don't think Lipinski would have been offered a lot. To stay with Harold Washington because he would have been dead in the 23rd Ward, so I think he was waiting for the opportunity for the Rich Daleys and the Verdoliaks and the Burks to move forward.
Now, also Ray Hanania writes that when Mayor Byrne started, so you would have already been in the organization when Mayor Byrne was elected in '83, that he was the floor leader for Jane Byrne. And that Ray Hanania writes in that article, I think he wrote it for the Chicago Reader, but it's kind of the primer article. If I were to teach a Chicago politics class, I'd give that Ray Hanania article out, that he was, first of all, teased, and you must have been at the time, as far as, you've always been known as a good dresser, I think, but that he had these orange corduroy suits, that he was, quote, and I've heard this from other aldermen, quote, and I don't want to, that I'm saying it racially, that he was, quote, the Pollock, unquote, dresser and alderman. Orange corduroy suits, corduroy, you know.
Yeah, he wasn't the best dresser when he was alderman. When he went to Congress, though, his attire changed, and he was a much better dresser. But when he was alderman, yeah, he did not wear the, yeah, he wore some outlandish colors and yeah, orange. Yeah, he was, I think they all kidded him about his orange sport coat or his orange suit or whatever it was. Yeah, but.
Now, he had an era that after he was the floor leader for Byrne, which would have been 79-83, because Harold Washington was elected in 83, that he was outside a room where DiArco, Rohde, and Verdoliak went into the room, and then they met for however long he was outside, and that he came out, and Verdoliak waved a finger at Lipinski and said, now you don't work, you work for us and not the grape anymore, the grape referring to Richard Daley, who was like the government in exile.
Okay.
Now, were you there at the time?
No, I wasn't.
Did Lipinski share any of this
with you?
No,
he didn't. To be honest with you, he didn't. I don't remember that at all. Okay. He never shared that with me.
Now, why did Lipinski stay so loyal to Daley? Because Lipinski even admits in the Hannity article that the Daleys were good friends when the Daleys were out of power, but they were in power while the 23rd Ward did get things. They certainly did not get as much as the 11th Ward or the 19th Ward, and that there were limitations on what the 23rd Ward got.
But you have to go back. The whole thing came back to the election with Ferry. Bill Lipinski was looking to move up from being alderman. The district, John Ferry was supposed to serve one more term, and then he was going to step down, and then they would figure out who was going to take the spot. Well, comes the 82 election, John Ferry says, no, I'm going to stay one more term. So the one more term, Bill Lipinski says, no, you promised the last term was going to be it. The key ward in that congressional district seat was the 11th Ward, and that was where Daley was still the state's attorney, and the 11th Ward was going to play a key role in this. And I remember Pat Hewells telling me that Daley had his usual Saturday morning meeting with a few of the guys, and he told Hewells, he says, you better make sure this Lipinski guy is going to win because I'm not going to back a loser. So Daley had a lot invested in his mind because Daley was still, at that point in time, was still thinking about running for mayor. Not still, he was thinking about running for mayor. And he wanted a congressman in there that was going to be loyal and help him out.
And you guys backed Daley, and you were part of that?
Absolutely, yes. Okay. Because that was, I mean, like I said, I got in there in 79, so in 82, I mean, Daley's organization was key. I mean, if you look at some of the votes out of that ward, some of those precincts, it was 350-5, you know, Lipinski beating Ferry. I mean, the 11th Ward was super.
Well, 83 was a very intense time for both racial reasons and political reasons. Now, Madigan supported Lipinski in 82, but Madigan did not support Daley in 83. But when I talked to former Alderman Madrick, he said that Madigan always had a superior position over Lipinski and controlled Lipinski. Would that be a fair and accurate
I don't know if that's fair and accurate, but I will say that Bill Lipinski would always call Mike Madigan for advice or for counsel or mm-hmm. for whatever. And I always said that Lipinski's congressional seat would last as long as Mike Madigan supported him, because the last 10 years that the entire 13th Ward was in the congressional district. So the Marty Russo-Lipinski race, there we go, where it was the opposite, not the opposite, but Daley was important in 82. In 92, it was Madigan that was important.
Right. And but for Madigan, Marty Russo may have won.
Oh, absolutely. I
but for Madigan, Dan Lipinski would not have won.
Absolutely, I agree. I mean, Madigan could bring out the votes, not only in his own ward, but in other wards.
Right.
So, yeah, I mean, Madigan, I would think in some people's eyes, it would look like Madigan had a superior position over Lipinski because Madigan could control Lipinski's destiny.
And you were pretty good with Madigan. You had given jobs to Madigan in the clerk's office.
Oh, absolutely.
And that Madigan and you had a very favorable relationship.
If you look at my clerk results, I mean, I think the 13th Ward was the highest vote count for Laski for city clerk in all of my elections. So, I mean, it was 13-23 always.
No. Now, I want to talk a little bit about when you became alderman. Some people think that the split between you and Lipinski was contrived. I know you deny that in this book.
Oh.
But there's people like Wally Carr and other operatives that we mentioned before the show, and there's people who have a theory that it was a contrived thing. So you could vote against the property tax increase. You still could be together. Lipinski could say to Daley that, hey, I'm going your way.
Yeah, I kicked him out. Yeah.
Right. And that's why you got the clerk's shop, because you never actually left Lipinski. So, and Wally Carr certainly was high up in the Lipinski organization. And I know that's a theory that he holds. Is it true that you and Lipinski never broke and you had a contrived...
It's the farthest thing from the truth. Because, I mean, if you look at the jobs that when I became city clerk, Bill Lipinski received no jobs from me. And he and I were, if you want to say, bitter enemies for a few years. I mean, it took a while before we mended fences. Even when he gave his tacit support for me for city clerk, it was a weak support. I mean, Lipinski and I never were really back where we were when I was there. So,
well, I remember you always had a shadow organization, because remember the 1998 election, yeah. He was supporting Glenn Pichard. I think you were supporting Glenn Pichard, but you went with Jesse White when he went with
McCarthy,
who was the police chief in Orland
Park,
because the South Side, Jeremiah Joyce, the South Side Irish, so to speak, as well as Madigan, Lipinski, they had, it was Pichard, McCarthy, McLaughlin, and that was your ticket. Whereas Genova was running from Calumet City, the mayor there, as well as Jesse White, and you had supported Jesse White.
Right, and that's not only the only election. I mean, he supported Phelan for governor, and I supported Netsch. I supported Pappas for county board president. He supported Paczynski. So yeah, there was a number of times that he and I were on opposite ends. I won for the candidate in the 23rd ward. Sometimes he won, but I mean, yeah, I had quite a strong organization for a while there.
Right, and your organization wasn't just based on jobs; it was also based on a kind of ideological 23rd ward anti-Lipinski or
philosophical basis why people supported me.
Right.
So you
and him really had a fight.
Absolutely. I mean, it was
not for show.
It was not planned, because Bill Lipinski wanted to show the Degnans and the Daleys that he can get the votes, that I was going to support the property tax. It was very important to Lipinski that he deliver Laski for the property tax vote. So.
Now, in the 1995 race, you were the slated candidate, so to speak. Mm-hmm. You were supported by Mayor Daley. You were supported by Madigan. But were you worried at all when another Polish candidate, T. Ron Jasinski Herbert, was running, who had some popularity in the Polish ethnic circles, and then Ricky Hendon was always running, that they could split up the white ethnic vote, and then Senator Ricky Hendon, I think it was senator even at that time,
he was state senator,
could have won.
Absolutely.
That race.
And if you look at what happened, that was before they changed the rules. That was a
primary.
If it was the way they hold the elections now, we would have had a runoff, because I didn't get 50% of the vote then. I only received 40-some percent of the vote, because Herbert took some votes away from me. Even though I won by a sizable amount, there was, you know, with three candidates.
But you didn't win by 50% of the vote.
I didn't get 50% of the vote, but it was, since it was a Democratic primary, you didn't need 50% of the vote.
So you went on, and the Republican was Mike Hollett, whose father was a famous... But the Republicans have a nominal presidency in the
city. Once you win the primary in the city of Chicago, you win the... Chances are you're going to win the general.
Now, you became very close with Edward Doliak also after you had the split with Lipinski. When Lipinski threw you out of the office, you were on Verdoliak's radio show. When you voted against the property tax, and he had a very popular, and I thought a very good radio show. I thought he was one of the better presents on radio.
With Ty
very
Ronsley.
Articulate.
Yeah.
Yeah, very funny. But you became the anti-property tax, anti-administration guy. How did you get that relationship? And then he gave you some good advice on property taxes, but he also gave you some bad advice, perhaps especially for the Democratic Party, on HIV.
Right. Well, see, Verdoliak had his radio show, like you said, and I became the maverick. I became the talk of the town with the property tax. So Eddie Verdoliak was looking to boost his ratings anyway, and I was a perfect guy to have on the show. We can both blast Daley.
And Verdoliak didn't like Daley.
No, he didn't, and it was just a mutual hate society because of what was going on. So, but you know, Verdoliak was doing his thing for his radio show, and I was just trying to survive, trying to get around the votes to vote against the property tax increase, which we in fact didn't need, because miraculously, Daley gets money from Washington D.C. to pay for the policeman's. Raises that he was going to raise the property taxes.
Now, you were going to, or you were close to Miriam Santos, who I think was first elected in 1991 as the treasurer. And then when Kozabowski got indicted, because Kozabowski also ran in 91, so the clerk of the city clerk was always a quote unquote 14th ward office.
Correct.
Dating back, I think, to Joe Burke, maybe.
And Marson. I mean, I don't know where Marson was, a North Sider. I don't know how the history.
But it was a Polish office.
Correct. That was, yeah.
By tradition. And it was the 14th Ward always had a role in the office, even if it wasn't for the 14th Ward. Mm-hmm. Now, How did you become close to Miriam Santos? And I have a more controversial question, because you could elaborate on that for a while. Do you think she was set up?
I became friends, first of all, I'll answer the first question. Miriam Santos and I became friends just because she was campaigning, and she came into the ward, and her and I just hit it off. I mean, you know, just a young, aggressive candidate. I like what she stood for, and her and I just became instant friends. We campaigned together in the ward, and then we campaigned together for citywide offices. She bucked Daley in the administration. I was told one time by John Cass that once they got Miriam, they were going to get me. When they said they were going to get you, he meant the Daley administration. Do I think she was set up? I don't think she was set up, but I don't think she was helped at all by the Daleys. She may have been hindered.
Well, according to Victor Crown, he believes that there was exculpatory information that was hidden. I know Victor Crown can seem somewhat eccentric, but he is smart and he is somewhat accurate. And I, you know, you did have a decision that her first guilty plea was reversed. She was taken out of prison, reinstated into her office, which is fairly unique. And then she took a lesser plea where she served no time. But she did get her law licensed.
And she was, her sentence was time served.
Right, her sentence was time served. And also for what she allegedly did, which is very common, because I kept on saying to myself, right, she yelled about fundraising. Now, she had a unique part because she was in a position where it's federally regulated because of banks. And that's what hurt her. But you don't think Victor Reyes ever called me up or my father or other people who had city contracts telling them they had to go with this candidate or that candidate or threatened them? So what Miriam Santos did, belly up to the table, is what any number of elected officials did. And I certainly know Victor Reyes did. So if Miriam Santos is in jail, why isn't Victor Reyes in jail?
Well, Miriam Santos is still my friend. Her and I talk on a weekly basis. And she still doesn't know exactly what she did wrong, how the world fell apart on her. But I talk about it in my book where... someone overheard a conversation between Daley and someone else, and actually heard them say that Daley say that Judge Norgel's going to throw the book at her.
Isn't Judge Norgel a Chicagoan?
That I don't know. Okay. I don't know. But I mean, there was talk about Daley says he has he has his tentacles. I've heard this from a lot of people that his tentacles reach beyond.
Well, if Mayor Daley helps elect President Clinton, for example, and you're a magistrate federal judge, if you want to get bumped up. Isn't there a politics within the federal court system, albeit a higher level one, albeit if you're appointed for lifetime appointments, but is there not a politics in the federal court system?
Here's what I'm going to say to all this. There's a history about Chicago, and there's a history about Chicago politics. We saw the power that Daley's father had, okay, and how he can, how presidents would come and sit down with him.
Well, he allegedly elected Kennedy.
That's what the allegations, that he helped turn that election against Nixon, and that the votes were stolen in Chicago, allegedly. But, I mean, there's a history of Chicago politics. There's a history of the Daleys. There's a history of the power and the manipulation. So, I mean, nothing would surprise me as far as if someone said that Daley has that kind of control and that kind of power where his tentacles reach beyond City Hall to other agencies, and that would not surprise me. And was Miriam Santos set up? I don't know if she was set up, but she certainly wasn't helped by the Daleys, and there was no tears shed when she went to jail. And I will go one step further, and I write it in the book, that when Scott Lazar prosecuted her, the U.S. attorney who prosecuted Miriam Santos, after she was indicted and after she was sentenced, Scott Lazar jumps on a plane with Daley to China.
Now, here's the, in 1995, Daley was doing the things that are being investigated by Patrick Fitzgerald now. Why would Scott Lazar be on a plane with Daley in China if Daley would be a person of interest or somebody that he is or could be or should be investigating?
Yeah, well, those are questions that only a few people can answer.
And also, why would Scott Lazar be saying complimentary things about Daley or traveling with him to China when he's investigating? And Silver Shovel, while significant, it was kind of rink-a-dink minority aldermen. Now, not to say they were bad aldermen. They did wrong things. It wasn't good what they did. But Hewles takes a loan for $1 million from Mike Tatum. I don't think he's paid back as of this today. Involved in all sorts of contracts, yet Hewles doesn't get indicted, but you have a couple Hispanic and black aldermen over small amounts of money.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Doesn't that raise a question of what the priorities are?
It's the culture of Chicago politics, like I've said. And when I talk about the book, is I talk about specifically, I say that I think Mayor Daley knows more than he says he knows. And, I mean, this is a guy who's a micromanager. This is a guy who wants the Olympics here. This is a guy who takes meticulous notes. This is a guy who I've been in a car with who can notice when a stop sign slightly turned or a street light's out. And yet, here's a guy who says, I don't know about who hired Angelo Torres. I don't know anything about hired trucks.
Well, let me back up on Angelo Torres. I know we were going to go more on hired trucks. You had dealt with Angelo Torres through your friends on the hired trucks. It was pretty common knowledge to get in the hired trucks program that you needed to be close to Angelo Torres. Yet Angelo Torres was a former 2-6 game runner. I actually ran into Angelo Torres recently. We had a long talk, and you know, it was kind of interesting, and I give him credit that he looked very good. He dresses very well, and you know, he said he's not gonna rat and a very stand-up guy, and maybe within his culture that's a lot of virtue. But it still begs the question is how a guy with no education, no management experience, no procurement experience, who was a former gang member, who had some problems with his previous employer, which was that anti-gang program that he supposedly took or didn't return or maybe even stole cell phones and other things, got into such a high-level position of being in charge of a hired trucks program that gave trucking contracts to friends of aldermen, known members of the mafia, and trucking companies that didn't seem to do a lot of work. And in fact, this show, one of the producers, I got to say, is Patrick McDonough, who was a whistleblower on hired trucks that said, hey, there's a bunch of trucks out here. They're not doing any work. They're sending city workers home, you know, from the union city worker perspective. But these trucks aren't doing any work. Pat McDonough, by the way, was rewarded by being terminated. I was his attorney, and we got his job back, and we're in the middle of a federal suit where Richard Rice, who I think is a cooperating witness with the federal government, is there. Don Tomczak, all these names are involved. So how did Angelo Torres get his job? Isn't it well known that all jobs went through Victor Reyes? When I went to people to get jobs, I had to go through Alderman Solis at that time, or Senator Munoz, who was in Senator, or whoever else, and ultimately had to go through Victor Reyes, through either Rosie Andolino or Greg Olsner.
I'll tell you the pecking order. Tim Degnan was in charge when I first got there in 90. After Degnan left, it was Pat Hewels and Victor Reyes. After Pat Hewels left, it was Victor Reyes. After Victor Reyes, it was John Doerr and Robert Sorich. And that's it. I mean, you had to go through those individuals, and they would tell you in no uncertain
terms. But that's where all the jobs went.
Right. But they would tell you in no uncertain terms, I have to check with the guy on five. I have to run that by him. I have to run this by the guy on five. There was only one guy on five. That's the guy who's the mayor of the city. So when they told me to my face that they had a check and just run it by him, that means they talked to him.
But what I understand is, like, the federal government, people kind of like on the North Shore, the Gold Coast, and the papers are all, like, surprised what you and I have known for 20 years or so, which is to get a city job, you have to do politics or donate it, and it's controlled. It's not a meritocracy. It's not controlled by Shackman. It's not because you apply and you got straight A's in your undergrad degree or you're qualified in typing.
Right. It's who you know, what you did, and work in the precincts.
So when they say that who got Angelo Torres the job, it has to be Victor Reyes.
Through somebody else who recommended him in the first place.
Right. Well, if his compadre is Senator Munoz, who's also compadres, which is godparent relationship, gumbade in Italian. I don't know what it is in Polish. I think cum or something like that. But it's, I mean, the probability it's Senator Munoz, who also got a lot of hired truck money, who sponsored him, and Victor Reyes got him the job. Because every time I dealt with the city of Chicago, all roads led to Victor Reyes. Because I kind of came on the scene when Degnan was playing less of a role.
Anyone who was head of the Intergovernmental Affairs Department, be it Degnan, be it Victor Reyes, be it John Doerr, those are the people that aldermen or committeemen would go to see regarding patronage. It was no secret.
And it wasn't not civil service, and it was not meritocracy.
No. I mean, I'll go back to 1979, 1980, when I first applied for a job. Lipinski sent me down there with a letter, an orange stationery, like his orange suit, to say this is to introduce Jim Laski, who's applying for a purchasing department.
But we all know that happened then, but Daley claims things have changed, that he hired personnel directors, and you had computers, and you had application process.
Well, that's what I talk about. You can read the book, too, and we talk about hiring practices, and we talk about how you can open up lists and how the Department of Personnel, you know, would, you know, Department of Personnel would still answer to the Soriches and the Reyeses, and, you know, lists would be open, lists would be closed.
Wasn't that proven now with guilty convictions of Sorich, Slattery, McCarthy, and Sullivan?
There was stuff that went on in the city of Chicago that there was problems with the hiring practices in the city. I've seen it. I mean, you know, and I've, you know, and people have, and obviously it's been proven now because there's money settlements that have been given out hand over fist.
Million.
Yeah.
I've had a number of clients that have made $75,000, $4,000, $75,000 in friends and clients of mine as an attorney. So it has to indicate something. now, let's, a little bit more on Miriam Santos. The mayor was obviously upset at Miriam Santos when she started looking into the pension. And I know the firefighters, who you were close to, viewed her as a hero because Ed Bedore and Tim Degnan were lending money to questionable deals, perhaps even illegal, but certainly bad investments, such as Paul Steppen and his hotel that I think $50 million got washed down the drain. Now, if I'm wrong on this, I always tell people, because people say you're wrong. If Paul Steppen wants to come on my show, if Tim Degnan wants to come on my show, if Ed Bedore wants to come on my show, please come on and I will give you your time to defend yourself or say. If I'm saying something, sue me. Sue me for defamation. Okay? You can, you know, Tim Degnan, please come on the show. Ed Bedore, please come on the show. And Miriam Santos, because I know she's a little less public than you. I think that she took this very hard, and without sounding sexist, maybe there's a difference with the female ability, you know, in prison. I don't know, and I'm not suggesting there is. But there was a poll done on the Hispanic popularity. And this is, you know, some years after she had already been in prison out of office.
Still up there.
The poll said that Miriam Santos was the most popular, more popular than Luis Gutierrez. Now, luckily, my father, who was the number one vote getter in MWR, didn't even spend a lot of money. And Kevin Joyce, 19th Ward, Skinny Sheehan, were all against him, as was Pat O'Connor, the alderman. Rob O'Connor, whose brother is in the Department of Water Management. And that's very interesting in terms of some of the things with Alderman O'Connor. But we'll get more on that later, is that my father was very high up there. And he was about third. But number one was Miriam Santos.
Yes. And she's still, I agree. She's still
so popular. And if you go to an Hispanic bar, Mexican or Puerto Rican, she happens to be Puerto Rican, but she was still popular with Mexicans. They will, the kind of bar talk and hair salon talk and rumor talk is that she was set up. That's what they believe. Now, I know this is not scientific and people could disagree with me, but the kind of rumor, political conspiracy talk is that Miriam Santos was set up and, well, what did she really do that was wrong? Now, I don't think she did something good. I don't think she did something right.
Here's the thing. Miriam Santos will tell you that Ed Bedore and Tim Degnan wanted to control her office, told her how to run her office. So she bucked.
But also controlled tens, if not hundreds of millions in pensions funds, which...
Miriam Santos was a very... a woman of integrity, was a fighter. She stood up for the taxpayers, and she was one who wanted to run her office her way. And they weren't going to allow her to do that. So she bucked, or Daley and her went butt heads right away because of that. But why she remains popular is because she's always still portrayed as that fighter. She was portrayed as someone who may have been, you know, people think she may have been set up. And she would have given him a run for his money for mayor.
Well, in 1995, I remember when the results were coming in, I heard from friends of mine who were supposedly in with Daley and that she was the top vote-getter.
Right.
She outdid Daley.
Correct.
And because you were in a contested race,
right,
it wasn't the same dynamic.
But in 99, I was the top vote getter.
Okay. In 99, well, you didn't have a contest in 99,
right,
though.
But, yeah.
But in 1995, and the Daley people were afraid because, okay, here's this Hispanic, educated, I think she had an MBA and a law degree, worked in the private sector at Ameritech, brother's a firefighter, blue-collar family coming up, you know. She was a fairly attractive woman. She could run for mayor one day.
Sure. Right. And the talk was that I would support her for mayor, and I would run for treasurer. So we were going to put our own ticket together, Miriam and I. And there was Miriam and I actually talked about putting our own ticket together.
Okay. Now, While you were in the clerk's office, there's a couple interesting parts of the book that I saw. One was is that you had an idea to withhold. You were in charge. Well, first of all, because I think a lot of our Buellians still doesn't know to this day. I mean, I know you get your sticker. I know if you have a bar, you do some licensing stuff. And
the city clerk's office issues 1.3 million vehicle stickers, over 100,000 business licenses.
I think it's coming up soon, so make sure you get them, otherwise you get a ticket.
And I still know all this. I'm not even a city clerk, and I still and we do dog we did dog licenses. City clerk's office still does dog licenses, and but I came up with some ideas. I was the first city clerk in Chicago to ever come up with legislative proposals, and I was the one who proposed
child support.
To deny a business license to anyone in the city of Chicago who is in arrears in child support.
Yeah, but Victor Reyes didn't want you to bring out the issue publicly. And he told you, don't have a press conference, we'll do it together. And you knew that the mayor's help would help pass legislation in Springfield.
Right, absolutely.
And I noticed in your book, because of your proposal, you've collected over $1 million in child support because of your proposal.
Correct.
And there are a lot of, unfortunately, deadbeat dads. So I guess sometimes deadbeat moms. But there are parents who don't pay for their kids, and you have a child support program in place. So you had this great idea. Your proposal did collect over $1 million. But Victor Reyes told you to stop. They kind of tricked you. Is that fair to say? Well, tell us what Victor Reyes did and what the mayor did.
He said, we're with you on this whole idea. You know, just hang in there. We're gonna come out with this. The mayor and you, we're gonna have a joint proposal here in the whole nine yards. And this is something I talked about when I was running for city clerk. This wasn't some new revelation. This was an idea that Laski had years before they actually stole it. And I say in the book they stole the idea, because Daley holds a press conference and he has this proposal about child support and denying the business licenses. And by the way, I'd like to thank Jim Laski for his support on this.
Now, some in the media did give you some credit, though.
Absolutely.
And you did get an award from NOW, the National Organization of Women.
Mm-hmm. But that goes to show you the mentality of the Daley administration.
Of cutting you out.
Cutting
you
out.
Taking all the credit.
And if it's not their idea, it's a bad idea, or we're going to make it our idea.
And also, Victor Ray is lying, because, you know, the joke with a lot of aldermen is, how can you tell when Victor Reyes is lying? His mouth is moving. You know, because he was always lying and tricking people. I mean, that was Victor's M.O., including aldermen that were close to administration. They would complain about Victor.
But, Frankie, it was the same thing with the employee indebtedness program, where I raised over $10 million.
Well, let's talk about it, because now there's two things. I read in the book how in the employee indebtedness program that Daley got so mad that he allegedly was throwing things around his office.
That's what Pat Hewels told me, because I went to Daley.
And broke a lamp.
Right, and that's what Pat Hewels told me. Daley's people... I went to Daley's people and said, I have this idea, and let's collect the money that's owed to us before we go out and start hitting people for, you know, new taxes, you know, and all that. I said, let's collect the money that's owed. Let's go after the people in the city employees who owe money for parking tickets, vehicle stickers, water bills, etc. I sat down with Diana Gotti at the time, who was the budget director, and this is when we were talking about new ideas, and she says, that's a good idea, but let's not talk about that right now. Let's just hold that to the side, and then we'll do something about that. And Daley's people, I went to them on numerous occasions. I was doing my own research, and my initial research showed that there was over $1 million out there. So when I was at a city council budget hearing, Alderman Munoz asked me, said, City Clerk, how's the indebtedness?
No, you didn't set that up?
No. No, thank
you. You didn't say to Munoz, hey, could you ask me? Because Munoz also had an adversarial relationship with the administration.
No, what it was is the only person, the reporter who was there at the time, was Bob Crawford from WBBM Radio. And I was praying, I'll be honest, I was praying that someone was going to ask me about the indebtedness program. And it was towards the end of the hearing, and Munoz asked, how's that idea going? I was like, thank God he asked me. So I said, it's going fine. He said, have you found out or anything? And I says, yeah, some employees in the city owe money. He says, oh, how much? I says, well, over $1 million. Bob Crawford's eyes blew up. I mean, Pat Hewels almost fell out of his chair, and then the whole thing started from there. But it ended up about $10 million was paid back to the city through the indebtedness program.
$10 million. So you helped. And this caused, because it wasn't Daley's idea, to throw, according to Pat Hewels telling you, right, that he's throwing things around his office.
Because he was so upset, because I went to his people about it, a guy by the name of John McDonough, other people.
John McDonough was intergovernmental affairs.
And they sat on it, and they didn't do anything, and I was just... I got to a point where I says, I hope someone asks me about this, because I'm going to tell them about it, because Daley's people aren't moving forward with this idea, and it
now,
was important.
Janet, who I, a long time ago, she used to be Frank Stenberg's secretary, and was very loyal to you, And remember, I dealt with her a lot on the property tax issues.
My
I always
personal
opposed
secretary,
property.
Janet.
Yeah,
right.
And she was very, I thought very good. If I were to be in your office, I'd love to have somebody like Janet. But I remember she's been around, she's an old timer now. I mean, she won't want me to say that, but she's been around for a while because she was Frank Stenberg's.
Right.
And then when Frank Stenberg had lost when the war turned Mexican to Jesus Garcia, she went south to the
Lipinski's organization,
then came in with you. And Janet said to you, Victor Reyes and Sheila O'Grady. And Sheila O'Grady was the mayor's chief of staff, and Sheila O'Grady is actually the sister to Paul O'Grady, who was the chief of staff to Sheriff Michael Sheehan. Sheila O'Grady is also, as you, those of you who watch the show on a regular basis, was the one who said that John Burge, we should sue John Burge and cut off his pension. And that was in the papers. So it's nothing that was in confidential documents that I'm revealing, even if it is also in confidential documents. It was in the newspaper, so I'm just reporting what was in the newspapers, that Sheila O'Grady had that idea, which actually probably helped my lawsuit against John Burge quite a bit. So Sheila and Victor are coming downstairs, and you are with Ray Drish, who is your very loyal right-hand man. Mm-hmm. And before you can even, like, kind of get ready, Janet brings in Victor Reyes.
And Sheila O'Grady.
Not unannounced, but they're coming down right now.
Right, coming down right now.
Okay, and then Victor has a letter.
He has a letter, and he says...
Now, let me break in. Oh. It sounds like almost like these medieval, you know, like a king or an emissary or, the ambassador, the court ambassador reading what the king is saying.
Right.
So I'm surprised why somebody couldn't call you, send the letter, why it's so dramatic. But tell us a little bit about that.
A couple of days prior, I met Daley about, I had some ideas about the Department of Revenue. The city clerk's office issued the license. Department of Revenue did all the paperwork. There was a lot of screw-ups, a lot of problems with the way the Department of Revenue was handling the business licenses. In fact, there were cases where a bar would get a heating and air conditioning license, a heating and air conditioning license would go to a tavern, would get a business license. Everything was getting screwed up. So I went to Daley and I says, I think maybe to streamline this whole operation, the city clerk's office should, instead of just issuing it, handle the paperwork too, because we're seeing all these errors with the Department of Revenue. Maybe we can, streamline this. The Restaurant Association was supportive of it. A number of other organizations, because there was a lot of problems going on. So during this whole conversation, Daley's writing all these notes, meticulously writing all these notes, 3, 4, 5 pages of notes. And he says, I'll get back to you. Well, what happened was a couple days later, Victor and Sheila O'Grady come down unannounced. Victor comes into my office, doesn't even shake my hand, stands in front of my desk and says, I have a letter to read from the mayor. Sheila O'Grady plops down, sits down on the couch, and he starts reading this letter. And the letter says that I take this as a personal affront if you try to take the business licenses or try to get the business licenses away from the Department of Revenue. You will not issue business licenses. The Department of Revenue will do that. And if you don't like it, we'll go to Springfield and take your statutory powers away from you. It was a very threatening letter. And it was just...
But he threatened not to do you any favors, threatened to go to Springfield and cut off your
powers. I consider it a personal affront if you pursue this business license.
So Daley said he takes it personally.
Right, he said this would be a personal affront.
Victor took it.
All Victor did was read the letter. Yeah. And after Victor finished the letter, he said, I don't even know if he said thank you or good day or whatever, he just walked out. Sheila got up and they had both walked out.
Like an ultimatum.
Yeah, but there was no pleasantries exchanged. Yeah. There was no anything. It was
courtesies, politeness,
nothing.
Now you said that you and Ray Drish felt like you were deers in the headlights.
Right, right. We were caught off totally off guard. We didn't know what they came in, didn't say hello, read a letter, and walked out. And then as soon as they got back to the office, I was getting calls from Springfield because Victor Reyes and his crew from Intergovernmental Affairs were already calling state representatives and committeemen and whatever down in Springfield saying if there's a battle that's going to come up between Laski and Daley, we want to know whose side you're on.
And Dan Burke got called.
Correct.
Because Dan Burke also worked in your office.
Right.
The brother of Alderman Ed Burke.
Right.
And Dan Burke said that Victor Reyes or somebody in the mayor's office called and said, which side are you
right, because Dan Burke called our office and said, what's going on out there? Because I just got a call, and then Eddie Burke got a call, and,
Now, let's talk a little bit about Big Don Tomczak. They called him Donnie, Big Don, Donnie Tomczak.
Right.
Okay. He was a big shot at the Department of Water Management. But I want to go back even further because he was on the outs with Daley.
Right.
And there's a third-party story that I want to attribute that Bill Lipinski was at a dinner with Dan Roskinkowski and Bill Daley. And I guess it was right after Daley got elected. And that Roskinkowski kept on repeating, what about Big Don? What about Donnie? What about Big Don? Because Daley didn't like Big Don Tomczak because he was with Mayor Byrne and went against
right.
Daley in 83.
Right.
and that he was Rostenkowski's guy, and that that was when Bill Daley, because of the pressure of Dan Rostenkowski, put Don Tomczak back on the payroll at Department of Water Management. And he had an army, he had a lot of people loyal to him, and he would go into elections. In fact, they said that people went down to, his son became the state's attorney, Republican state's attorney of Will County. And he went in, Jay Stone, who is the son of Alderman Bernard Stone, and a friend and a client of mine, he got $75,000 under the original Shackman premise, which is that when Shackman ran for constitutional convention and lost, that it was because machine precinct captains who had jobs were working against him, and that's unfair, and that's how the whole Shackman thing came into play. Could be wrong, and we'll have Mike Shackman on soon, and I've talked. But Jay Stone won $75,000 primarily because Big Don Tomczak had an army of workers that worked for Ted Matlack. Okay. What was, tell us a little bit about Don Tomczak.
Don Tomczak was the old-time politician, and he'd have a cigar in his hand.
Yeah, he was a cigar chomping.
Yeah. But he, I'd be in his office, you know, talking to him about getting trucks on for a couple of my former friends, and there'd be a phone call from a Robert Sorich, or there'd be a phone call from a Victor Reyes, or
to go into this war, go into that war.
Or just come and see me, we're going to have a meeting, and Tomczak would tell me, yeah, I got to get some guys together for this election, that election.
And he got people jobs.
Oh, yeah, anybody.
He did people favors.
Oh, yeah, but Tomczak also took care of his guys, you know, with overtime, and they had to help him with his son's elections and stuff. And
But know. Didn't people also help him with cash?
As far as I know, I mean, I knew people who worked for him, and there's a guy I wrote about in the book, Randy, who was he had to go around collecting money for Tomczak for birthday or Christmas or whatever. So yeah, I mean,
now yeah. He also helped you, and you eventually got in trouble for.
Correct.
Okay, you know, and we're almost out of time. I got to say, you got to read this book. I'm pretty much I'm not completely through it. And it's something you got to read twice. And because if you're a political junkie out there, it's My Fall from Grace, City Hall, The Prison Walls. And I guess it's online also at public libraries. And I would suggest anybody to read the book. I think it's a great
book. It's available
book.
At bookstores and, yeah. and online.
But at any rate, we're almost out of time. We got to do a whole other show because we barely got into how you got in trouble.
Right, and about prison. And that's a whole other. Yeah. You know.
And I do want to talk to you about prison. But you seem good now. Because I never knew when I knew you, and I've known you for some time, that you drank heavily, or I remember the last time I saw you before today, and we've talked, you know, you had sunglasses on, you looked like you had partied all night, you know, yeah. or cocktailed all night on Rush Street or something, but that you had a pill problem.
Yeah, I was taking Valium, and I was drinking too much.
With booze.
With beer. I was drinking beer.
And you were taking money.
From former friends, right?
Yeah, and relatively small amounts.
I think I was indicted for taking $48,000.
And probably you, according to the law, also some.